I am here today to talk to you about five flowers that I grow in my garden that I absolutely love. And not only do they add like beautiful color to your garden, but they are so useful. So the first one I want to talk about, I actually have right behind me. Let's see if I can just pulled up that whole thing. Is echinacea, purple cone flower. You probably are already growing this in your yard. You see it all over the nurseries, but you may not know that it has some medicinal properties. A few ways to harvest this is you're gonna pull it up, you're gonna get the root. So this one, I did not mean to do this, but, and it's a little baby one. So this one, you wouldn't really get the root. But with some of your more established plants, if you've had echinacea for 2-3 years, preferably, you pull up that root, you chop it up, you dry it out, and you can use that for teas. Just blend it with anything. If you do elderberry, one of my favorite teas that I have, I call it my berry wellness tea, and it has echinacea root, and then it has dried elderberry and dried ginger and dried lemon and a bunch of other things in it that it's so good. So the first thing you can do with it is make teas. Another thing that you can do with it is make a tincture. So what you'll do for the tincture, you can just get the root, get the stems, get the leaves, smash it into a like pint-sized mason jar or bigger, and fill the rest of that jar up with vodka, 80 proof vodka. And then you just let that sit in a cool, dark place for about 4 to 6 weeks, and it'll be ready. You strain out all the flowers and the roots and everything like that, and you just store it in your cupboard until you need it. When you need it, our family, so I'm not a doctor, or I'm not giving you medical advice is my disclaimer here. But the way our family does it is we take like a teaspoon a day, or a teaspoon when we're feeling sick, not a day. I usually only take it if I'm sick. And it helps you so much. It is filled with antioxidants. It has antimicrobial properties as well, and so it'll boost your immune system, a bunch of different things. So research it more if you want to know why echinacea is so good and why I love it so much. The second thing you can do with that tincture that you made is you can add it to like a glass spray bottle, and anytime you have like a sore throat or you're dealing with strep or something like that, you can use it and just spray it at the back of your throat, and it works great that way as well. Like I said, go to your doctors if you're having issues, whatever you prefer to do for your own health. This is just what our family does. Oh, and another thing you can do is you can infuse it with honey. So if you haven't already started infusing garlic in honey, it's so good for you. It comes in handy. So when you guys have a cough or anything like that, a natural cough syrup, just to help with that. And plus honey is just so beneficial to you. So you could do the same thing with the echinacea. You could use the roots. You can use the flower heads or whatever you want. The root of the plant is actually going to have the most medicinal properties to it, but the whole plant is good. Well, the flower stems and the flower head. So go ahead and add that to a jar, add honey to it, and then you can have like an echinacea honey infused. Echinacea is very drought tolerant, so meaning that it did great in New Mexico for me, and it's also gonna do great here in Texas because of the humidity. I'm sure what come July and stuff, we're probably not gonna be getting as much rain. So it really is, once you get it established, it's a really easy plant to care for, and I would just designate an area to it because it's so beautiful. You can just see how beautiful it is. I really love these light purple ones. They're all beautiful. This one is just so pretty. And echinacea also makes great cutting flowers. You can see how long the stem is here too. That's like an extra thing. So they make great bouquets and cutting flowers. This one is just getting all the love. One I want to talk about is yarrow. My yarrow is not in bloom quite yet, and so I am just going to show you the leaves of my plant so you can kind of see what it looks like. But yarrow, the leaves are also usable, so you can use the leaves, the flowers, to make all the things I'm going to let you know about. one thing to keep in mind when you are harvesting your yarrow is it is perennial, so it'll come back every year, and so you don't want to harvest too much of the plant. Usually you only want to harvest about like 1/3 of the plant. That way you leave enough leaves and everything like that so it can regenerate and you can harvest throughout the season. So if yours does not have blooms yet, you can still harvest. I am going to wait to harvest any of my yarrow until I get some flowers on it, just because I think it'll be really beautiful. And then once my plants get a little bit bigger, and let me show you what that looks like.
See it here. This is just a makeshift herbal bed that I made in my garden. And I have different yarrow in here. And yarrow is also an antiseptic. It's anti-inflammatory. And it helps stop.
What you can do with those leaves and the flowers is you can smash them up. If you have, mortar and pestle, is that how you say it? Bowl, you just smash up the leaves and the flowers. And then you can make a little poultice out of it and go ahead and put that on any area that you're having. I can hear my goats. They sound like they're in distress, but they're not. They keep jumping up on this table, and then when I go to get them, then they know how to get down and they just jump down. So they're totally fine, but I can hear my little goat back there. So it helps stop bleeding. It's antimicrobial. And it's really good for you. Another thing that you can do, so you could do the poultice.
You can make teas with it. So this is a lot of the flowers and stuff that I'm going to show you today, I use for teas because I love teas. I drink teas all the time. I drink it year round because it's amazing and delicious. And so the next thing you can do with it is make it into a tea. It also helps with fever. So if you have a fever, go ahead and add some peppermint, some of the yarrow, and boil it. You can dehydrate it, dry it, and store it that way, or you could just pick it fresh. I should go check on my goat. One thing I want to note before I forget, because I know I will forget, is that you do not want to use this when you're pregnant. So because you could do different salves and different things like that with, but this one you do not want to use while you're pregnant because it can cause like uterine contractions and things like that. And so there is risk, I believe, even with like miscarriage and things if you use it while pregnant. So just be mindful of that. If you're pregnant, skip this one for now. If you're not pregnant, it's great. So another thing you can do with it is make another tincture. And with this tincture, it's so good for your skin, and since it has those antimicrobial properties, it's also great for like as an astringent. So you can use I hear my kiddos coming. So you can use the 80 proof vodka again, stuff the leaves in there, the flowers in there, let that sit for 4 to 6 weeks, and then you can use that on your skin, like if you have acne, different things like that. Of course, it's going to be alcohol, so you don't want to just be using it all the time because it can be drying, but especially for like acne and things like that, it is a good natural option for you to use. They're going to go check on that goat. My daughter is going meh at it, back at it. So okay, so this next one I'm going to talk to you guys about is actually something that is new to me. So when I was a little girl, I used to love picking rose petals and making my own perfumes and doing all the things with them. And now as an adult, I still like roses and I still love using the rose petals, but this time I dry the leaves and I use it for bath salts. I like to make like a herbal bath tea with chamomile, just put it in like a cheesecloth. So like chamomile, lavender, rose petals, Epsom salt, and you can soak in that. It's wonderful. It smells amazing. But you can see here, I have these really tiny baby roses. I bought these at Costco this year. It was like, came in a 2-pack, 2 for $15, the bare root. And so these are very tiny. And so I am going to go ahead and cut these flowers off, this one right here, in the beginning of the season. But as the season goes on, I'm going to start leaving it. So later on in the season, I am not going to deadhead these flowers. I'm going to leave them, and what it will grow is a rose hip. So most rose plants will do that. A lot of time you don't see that because we deadhead them. So that's what I'm going to do. There are certain varieties. Like I said, this is going to be my first time harvesting rose hips. So I'm not really sure which varieties are best. I did do a little bit of research. I don't know how to pronounce a lot of the rose varieties. So
I'm going to let you do that research and which ones you want to grow. Plus, it's more fun for you to do it so that you can look at the roses and see which ones look beautiful to you and which ones you want in your garden. But I'm definitely going to plant some more roses, definitely going to harvest rose hips. They are so high in they're very rich in vitamin C, and so they actually have more vitamin C than an orange. So if you didn't know that, that is super cool. You can eat them fresh, just right off the plant, but they do have in the inside, they have like their seeds, and so they do have a furry lining in there that will upset your stomach. So you don't want to eat that part. You probably just want to eat around it. You can cut it up, scoop that part out, eat it fresh like that. You can make it into rose hip teas, dehydrate it, add it to your teas. It's amazing. It's delicious. I have had rose hip tea, just not harvested from my own garden. So that is a great thing you can do with it. And you could do the tea. You can also make another astringent. You can use this on your face. You can even add it and make like a type of salve. So most salves, all you're gonna need is like beeswax and oil. So you can use like the rose petals. You can use the dried rose hips and soak it in oil, and then use that oil like an almond oil or something like that. Okay, one second, honey. So then you could use the almond oil with the rose hips, the dried rose hips in it. Take that out, soak that for about 4 to 6 weeks. A lot of things is 4 to 6 weeks. And then use that oil with some beeswax and things like that. Heat it up on the stove, make a salve. It will be wonderful. It'll feel so good on your skin. So another great use for roses and rose hips. Thing with the rose hips is you can go ahead and leave the rose hips on there for a light frost. You do not want to leave them on for a hard frost because they're going to get mushy, soggy, and be bad. But with a light frost, they are supposed to get a little bit sweeter. So they are going to be pretty tart when you try them. I love tart things like pomegranate, things like that is just so delicious to me. My husband, on the other hand, I bought some pomegranate juice and he was like, "You said this was amazing," and he didn't think it was that great. But to me, it was delicious. Like cranberries, all of that I love. So if you like tart, pick it before a light frost. If not, leave it for a light frost and then pick it after, and it should be sweet. So this next one I'm going to talk about is nasturtiums. I talk about them all the time. I love them. They are beautiful. They're fun. They come in so many different varieties. Super easy to grow. They don't really love the heat as much, and so if you're growing them in your garden, as it gets really hot, you might want to have an area that it's like partial shade, because they do need the sun, but partial shade will extend their season. You want to soak the seeds before you plant them. You can actually, the whole plant is edible. You can eat the, I'll show you them here in just a second, but the leaves are edible, the flowers are edible. They're so delicious. If you like radishes, you will like these. They're like, to me, it tastes like a mild radish, and I personally don't love radishes, just like a few, like maybe on tacos, but eating a fresh radish I don't typically love. But these are like the perfect kick to a salad or something like that, and they're beautiful because you get to add flowers and it just looks fancy. They are also a great companion plant. So I am not huge, I do plant certain things in my garden like nasturtiums, and I like marigolds, things like that, as companion plants, but I don't focus so heavily on them in my garden. Just in a way where I like have to have the right companion plants next to a plant. Of course, as you garden more, you can plant things more specifically together. But when you're getting started out, don't worry about companion planting. Just plant your seeds. That is good enough, and you can learn as you go. And so with that being said, if you need a companion plant, plant some nasturtiums. I just tuck them in the corners of my beds, and they actually help deter pests and like aphids and squash bugs. So like say you have cucumber beetles, things like that, it'll attract them to that plant rather than attacking your vegetables. So I'd rather lose a nasturtium plant to squash bugs than all my pumpkins or all my squash or all the things. So that is another great purpose for nasturtiums. Another thing you can do is pick off the flower head, and then you can just freeze those in little ice cubes, make some lemonade, add the ice cubes to it, and it'll be beautiful. Or you can add it to like water or whatever, just for a pop of color, and you can feel safe putting it in there because it's here is my green stock. You can see these beautiful nasturtiums. They just started setting flowers, you can see. here, like I said, the whole plant is edible, and you can imagine having these in a salad. They're just so beautiful. The flowers, it's just really, really pretty. So those are the nasturtiums. These are a couple different varieties. This is a more variegated plant here, so these are extra pretty too. Pretty peach color. These are the only ones that have started to produce yet. I have some tucked in the corners of my beds here, and none of those ones have started to bloom. When the flowers are done flowering, they'll set off little seed pods, and those you can use as capers. So you can make like a lemon pasta and add some capers. You can look up different recipes. There's plenty of them out there on Pinterest and things like that for a yummy nasturtium capers recipe. So that's also a great and fun way to use your nasturtium. The last thing I'm going to talk to you about is calendula. I had a friend, she called it calendula. I have no idea how to pronounce it. I think it's calendula, but calendula is also a great companion plant. It's beautiful in the garden. It is something that I love to have on hand. It's great for like skin issues. If you have a baby who has like eczema or like skin rashes or just has really sensitive skin, you can make so many things for your baby with this, or even yourself. If you have eczema, dry skin, you can make different lotions with it. You can make different salves, you can make chapstick, you can make so many things with it. And basically, all you're gonna need to do is fill up a jar with the calendula, the flower heads, and fill up a jar with it, fill it with an oil of your choice, almond oil. Let's see, what else could you use? You could even use coconut oil. You will have to melt that down first. Whatever oil base you wanna use, soak that for 4 to 6 weeks, and then when you're done, strain out the flowers and go ahead and save that. You can use that with beeswax and different things to make your lotions and all yourselves. I love it even for the oil. I love it for my face, like when it's dry out and stuff. I'll use it as like a face oil. You can use it as like a makeup remover. Wash your face with the oil first and then use whatever skincare products you want after. It's really good for your skin. So, and it's very soothing, so it's not really harsh or anything like that. I use it a lot. I have like this much left of my oil left from last year's garden, and I planted a bunch of calendula, but it is so slow growing. Last year I had only planted it from started plants, and this year I don't know if I started them late or if they're just a little bit slower to grow. But so I don't have any flowers to show you today, but I have plenty in my garden and I'm hoping that they will do great. Calendula is also great because it is frost tolerant, and so of course when it gets really cold, it's not going to last the whole season, but with a frost and everything, it'll be fine, and it actually does better in cooler temperatures. So I guess it's not the end of the world that I haven't been able to harvest any of it yet. So calendula is antiviral, antimicrobial, anti-inflammatory. It helps with cramping. You can make a little salve, put it on your stomach. You can make it in teas. You just dry the flowers. You can just leave the flowers whole. That's kind of what I do, is I just pop off the heads, stick them in the dehydrator, or I just lay them on parchment paper, lay them out, and then they dry, stick them in a jar. And I use the flower heads for all the things. And I also like chop up the flower heads or just peel off the petals of the flower heads, put those in teas, and it's so soothing. So if you're cramping, if you're sick, I also have calendula in my berry well tea, and I also have it in my sleepy time tea because it's soothing. So it's really a great flower to have in your garden. It's pretty. They have so many different colors too that you can choose from. I read somewhere once that the orange has the most, I don't know if it was like, how do I say this? It was basically the most potent. I don't know if that's true. I think I literally read it from one source and it's stuck in my head. So I always plant the yellow and orange varieties, but they have all kinds of different kinds. They even have like a tiger striped one, a bunch of different things. So I hope you guys enjoyed this video. I hope you learned something. If you guys have different flowers that you grow in your garden, let me know. Let me know how you use them. Thank you so much for watching. I love talking about this stuff. It's so fun for me. If you are growing anything in your garden you absolutely love and you want to share it with others, please let me know. I will probably do another video
about some of the other things I love to grow in my garden, but I figured I would keep it to five things today. That way this video doesn't last forever. So.